because I, yeah, it's just like, I don't even know, like, eating consistently has always been sort of an issue for me, especially like if I'm, you know, stressed or whatever. But even just knowing, like, okay, like, what am I looking for? Like, what do I need? It's like, what do I need to be putting in my body? Like, you know, regardless of, like, you know, whether I'm busy, like, even like making like a better bad choice, like if I'm out like on the road, because like I feel like I'm always like constantly moving and doing stuff. So I'm like, anyway. So yeah, let's dive in.
Okay.
All right. So I don't think you know like everything, but like, I mean, you know some of it, but ultimately I need some cognitive support and I need gut health support. So, and obviously like my diet has not been, you know, entirely the best in the past, but I have been, I guess, struggling with this for quite some time. So I'm just kind of at a loss of like how to come back from it.
Okay, so tell me more about when you say I need help with my gut. What does that mean?
So that means I eat something and it comes out in one form or fashion like 2 minutes later. So IBS type of stuff.
Okay. So in just hearing that, I automatically would know that there was some kind of stress component involved, right?
Right.
So stress leading to a strengthened sympathetic nervous system, right? And so we need to strengthen the vagus nerve and the parasympathetic side. Which, what does that mean? It's that calming, that rest and digest state that helps us to digest food a little more properly. So one of the things that you could do always before you eat, if you could remember, is to take some deep breaths. If you're a praying kind of person, you can make sure that you say a prayer and you take a pause moment, because that actually is one of the quickest ways for us to switch over into our parasympathetic mode, right?
Okay.
So just that alone can help to slow down digestion if you can make sure you're taking that pause and long enough. So running around on the road and we're grabbing this and we're driving and we're shoving the food into our mouth, that's not gonna end well with that kind of situation, right?
Right.
So if pausing a little more, making sure you're not eating in a rush state would be number one.
Okay.
Second of all, have you ever dug into any testing on what the microbiome of your gut looks like?
Yes, I don't have those results back yet, but I will in about 2 weeks, and so I'm excited to kind of dive into that and really see what's up, because I'm sure it's all out of whack.
That is exciting, because that actually will tell a lot and be able to know how to help. So usually the microbiome, when it gets off for one reason or another, it is hard to get back into balance, especially if there are specific bacteria or bugs that have overgrown. If there's candida in there, does that need to be addressed? Is there C. difficile? Does that need to be addressed?
No, I know I have a massive candida overgrowth problem, so that's been a challenge to sort of figure out, okay, how do I rein that back in?
Okay, so candida, all of this is... they're all very, very specific, believe it or not. It's a fungus, right?
Right.
A yeast. And so that would require certain, I want to say, antifungals to address. When you can do that with supplements, you can do that with endocelic acid. That's another kind. So there are different strategies that you can use as far as supplements go. But then also from the dietary side of things, the first thing to remove, right, is what feeds it.
Sugar.
Yes. So refined carbs and sugars feed candida. So even, you know, it's probably one of the hardest diets out there is the candida diet. You know, we try to do those from maybe a 30, a 60, a 90 day approach. Helps the brain a little bit to not feel like, oh, you know, there's an end in sight basically. And so you can do a really hard hit 30 day. And then maybe start to try to reincorporate some things and see, you know, what progress that you've made. So really reducing what foods feed the candida is another part of that.
Okay. Cool. So what exactly does that protocol look like?
For what, the anti-candida diet?
Right.
So, yeah, well, it's probably a 3-page paper, but in general, you want to take out refined carbohydrates. So those turn into sugars, right? And then that's what feeds the yeast. So breads, bagels, right? Any of these starches should be out. You know, we should focus on whole foods, vegetables. You know, even I would say most of the fruits need to come out with the exception of dark berries. So you can do probably a quarter cup blueberries a day and still be okay. But as long as you're focusing on like the veggies, the green vegetables, especially, can be super helpful. And your proteins are always allowed on the anti-keto diet. So you get your good proteins, your good veggies, your dark berries, your nuts and seeds are going to be fine. So you're really looking at a whole foods, but minus the high glycemic fruits and minus the grains. There are a couple that are actually allowed, so we should point that out, like quinoa is a great one to do and include. Buckwheat is another one because it's very low glycemic. So yes, it does get very restrictive, but if you can look at it as a temporary type approach and do some good planning, then I think that most people can do it.
Gotcha.
Is that helpful?
That is helpful, yes. Thank you. So I guess one of my big things, because like, have you ever found with certain people that they might, like, the grocery store like just overwhelms the crap out of them?
Yes.
I'm one of those people.
Okay.
So how is the best way to sort of like, I guess, navigate that?
Know what your goal is. Let's say, for example, you decide my goal for the next 30 days is to do an anti. Okay, that gives you some direction right away, right? You're not going to be all over the place in the grocery store. You know that you're focused in on some certain foods. There is some great information online that you could go to find. There's a website that we love called the CanetaDiet.com. I was talking earlier, you should have done it before. I would start with the guidelines. Like, what does that look like? And then jot down some notes, what that means, okay? And then when you know your no's, that's fine. Now we just need to move right on to the yeses. So what are the yeses? That's that list of foods that we can buy when we go to the grocery store. So we're going to the produce section. We're going to the meat section, right? We're probably staying away from a lot of the processed sections of the grocery store, which generally are in the middle, if you remember.
Right.
And just making sure whatever you're getting, you know, not olives, something like that would be fine, and that would be in the, or nuts and seeds, right? Those are going to be in other sections. But just keeping in mind where you know where to go. And sometimes just making a list can be very helpful to just get you to those sections you need to go. But you also have to do a little bit of meal planning.
Mm-hmm.
Whole foods diets are actually very simple because you're talking about turkey patties and a side salad, right? I mean, it's not that hard. It's just, you know, you have to get your brain into the mode of simplicity and what you're trying to accomplish.
Yeah, simplicity always seems to be the hardest part. Like, okay, like this is the thing. Now just do it.
Yeah.
You know, that's always the biggest kicker, I think. So definitely what I've learned in this little project that I'm doing. So yeah, that's super helpful.
Good.
Thank you. I guess any other tips or tricks you can possibly think of?
Tips or tricks? You know, I do think that planning can help people out. But you don't want to spend so much time planning that then it becomes a nuisance to you, or, you know, you don't want to do it anymore. And so whenever that downtime is, most people, Sundays, there seems to be at least an hour or two that they could sit down and just jot down some meals that sound good, you know, whether it's some tacos or it's salads, it's whatever those meals are, because everybody has their own, you know, their own flavors that they like. So jotting those things down on a Sunday can really help when you're going to the grocery store. And I always tell people, when you're cooking dinner, if you're going to take the time to cook dinner, make it count for lunch the next day.
Right.
And then you're not grabbing something when you're out and about, and you can still eat something that's healthy and that you like because you made it, right? Mm-hmm. So I think that is a good little trick for people.
Gotcha. what are some of your favorite like resources for, like, I always hate like when I go through and like I'm trying to find like a healthy recipe and then like it's like 12 ingredients. Like, what are some of your favorite resources for like recipes that, you know, might be a little bit more simple, especially like if you don't have high cooking skill?
I have kind of gotten away from recipes myself, okay, much for the same reason. And this is what I was telling you. I think, you know, some of my favorite dishes I can just share with you. I eat fish twice a week. So the only fish that I eat are gonna be Atlantic cod and wild caught salmon. So I will go most of the times get those from HEB and then either eat them the same day I get them or the next day. Because the fresh, you wanna eat fish fresher, mm-hmm, right?
Right?
Otherwise that builds histamine. So right, the fresher you eat him, the better. And then I have my favorite two little recipes that I make. I put paleo, the Primal Kitchen mayonnaise on top of my Atlantic cod, and I put some dill on top and pop him in the oven, and that's how I make him with broccoli. It's literally that simple. It doesn't take me very long. The salmon recipe is a basil pesto with some crunched up pecans that I buy already crunched up, right? And I top that with it. Mm-hmm. So I'm having that, and it tastes like a gourmet meal, right? With maybe a side of asparagus.
Gotcha.
So right off the bat, there's two meals, and we should be having fish twice a week. Everybody should. So that would just be like, that takes your Sunday afternoon. What do I really like? What can I get used to making and rotating so that I'm not eating the same thing every day, right? We rotate our proteins the best that we can, and then utilizing when we are in front of the stove that time to make sure that it counts and we can at least get two meals out of it.
Mm-hmm. Cool. So once again, keeping it super simple and not overthinking it.
It's super simple. I'm yeah, not in there trying to find recipes. That's definitely not what I do. I find my favorites, make it easy. Everything's less than 30 minutes, right?
Right. Cool. I love that because I'm all about finding things I can just, okay, like, let me just pour some things together and it's good and healthy and, you know, so like chia seed pudding was like one of my favorite things to just like sort of do. And like, so I've gotten in the habit of like doing like smoothies in the morning.
Perfect.
And
hard boil some eggs the night before, crack those open, have them right, especially if you're on the run.
Yeah.
Things like that can be really nice. Or making turkey patties and then for one night, and then maybe you're putting them with a vegetable and something else, right? And then you make extra turkey patty and you put that on a bed of lettuce for your little lunch the next day, right?
Right.
So making things just go further.
Yeah.
Being simple.
Cool. Well, I appreciate your time today. Thank you so much.
You're welcome. Thanks for having me, Lauren.